It's great to be here. I'm very excited to talk to you about some latest AI work at the Microsoft and the Microsoft Research. But more importantly, I want to talk about two topics, very timely topics in AI. It's called AI bias and explainable AI. Let me first of all share some of these latest AI breakthroughs. We're actually gradually approaching human parity in a number of those human tasks, especially perception, from computer vision to speech to more and more natural language. The leftmost is actually talking about our work in object recognition. Some of you might know that ResNet now is the most popular deep neural net in computer vision. We actually invented in our research lab in Beijing by my students using 152 layers of neural networks. We accomplished 96% of the accuracy for ImageNet. That is really the image database that people typically use to do recognition. That's really amazing, in a way that this is at least as good as any Stanford graduate student to do this kind of recognition. The second box shows our progress in speech recognition. In speech, there's this very standard data set called the switchboard data set that is really recording of from two sides and phone conversations. 2 years ago, we accomplished 5.1% of the error rate. That is really, really amazing. This is actually the human error rate, 5.2% is for those people, professionals, doing transcripts. Most of us actually have up to 9% of the error rate when we do speech recognition. You may not believe in me saying that we actually have such a high error rate, but you understand that you go home, talk to your spouse. So we continue to march on and really are making a lot of progress in machine reading comprehension using Stanford Squat database. And also in machine translation, this 69.9% number is actually for English Chinese and Chinese English translation on the news corpus. And most recently, we have been working on even conversational AI. All those things shows that we're actually gradually approaching human parity. But what does this really mean? It means that we actually now can enable a lot of interesting innovations. Let me give you an example that we have been working hard in China and Japan. It's actually a social chatbot called Xiaoice. Xiaoice now is very popular with 120 million monthly active users. But even more interestingly, she's very famous in China. She's on 60 TV programs and the radio shows. And she's very creative. She actually writes music and sings very well. And she is also a good writer, and she writes poems. She actually published a book. I actually wrote a foreword for this book. And she can paint. Amazingly, she actually, using a pseudonym, she actually accomplished her work and graduated from Chinese Central Academy of Fine Arts this summer as a master's student. It's really, really amazing. But what's most exciting to me is how we have been designing this social chatbot by incorporating EQ. That's very important because with IQ, we help people to accomplish tasks. And with EQ, we have empathy. We have the social skills and the understanding of human beings' feelings and emotions. And that's important because that is going to help the chatbots to really extend the length of conversation. I'm sure you use some kind of digital assistance, whether on your phone or with speakers. But the typical digital assistants on the market will have roughly a few turns of conversation with you. But Xiaoice CPS, or conversation turns per session, on average, actually achieves 23 times. That is a stunning number. Incredibly, the longest conversation any human user ever talked to Xiaoice is actually over 29 hours of 7,000 turns. I guess some people just have too much time. So then you say, well, you have this kind of capability. What can you really do for business? I give you a very exciting example that we have collaborated with Lawson, which is the second biggest retail chain in Japan. So we use Xiaoice and Xiaoice EQ to power Akiko. That is really the voice persona. That's the persona, the online persona that Lawson has. So we did an experiment with Lawson and using Akiko. We basically have Akiko talk to the Japanese users, and she can chat, she can do product recommendation, and she can conduct surveys at the appropriate time, and she can even distribute coupons. So we did the experiment with the coupons, and amazing that we distributed 1 million coupons in 13 hours, and the in-store conversion rate hit 40% in the next 4 days. Now, for those of you who understand the coupons, this is really an amazing number. And of course, we can apply all this kind of technologies to different verticals. We actually now power 90% of the quarterly earning report summary for 90% of Chinese companies, and also powered by Xiaoice. All those things are possible because of the huge amount of data that we actually use to train AI. So nowadays, with more and more data used in AI, and with more and more complex AI models, especially with deep learning models, we actually face some serious challenges. In particular, AI bias and explainable AI. I assume that many of us in the room probably have seen DHH's tweets a few days ago about the Apple Car and created by Goldman Sachs. Now, if you think about what really happened, you probably would agree with me that very likely there's some kind of AI bias in the machine learning system they have built, and they really need to do a better job and to have this kind of explainable AI, why this kind of credit decisions were made. So let me give you another motivational example that we actually have been working on in Microsoft. So NPR interviewed my colleagues and they wrote this article. It's called, "He is Brilliant. She's Lovely, Teaching Computers to Be Less Sexist." So we actually trained in the machine learning system to do job classification. So we actually defined 27 jobs titles at the bottom. Then we took someone's bio, and this person is a philanthropist, but we don't really have philanthropists in our training. So then we run through the system, and with this bio, and the system says, this person is a teacher. Well, this is reasonable, and if you read the text. But if we change nothing but only a few words from she to he, from her to his, this is what the system says. Now you start to see the problem. Maybe this machine learning system is not as accurate as you would like to see. It might have some inherent bias because of the data we use to train that. So what's really happening there? So we decide to dig into that and use something in natural language processing called a word embedding. It's a geometry, multi-dimensional geometry, but there are really two very important concepts. That is called proximity and parallelism. If you think about Apple and Microsoft, and you think about Cupertino and Redmond, you say, well, they're really very, very much strongly correlated. Cupertino to Apple as the location is the same as Redmond to Microsoft. Similarly, and Steve Jobs and Bill Gates, they are founders of those companies. So now let's use this word embedding to take a look at the relationship between he and she. So she to he is analogous to sister to, I'm sure you guys know, so brother. Okay, so far so good, let me warm you up. And she is a nurse and he is, now you start to see some problem. All right. So she is a homemaker and he is a computer programmer. By the way, we didn't do anything. Actually, in fact, we used the training data set is even coming from Google. So it's nothing to do with us, and it's really in the data. So, So now, she says, oh my God. And what would he say? Don't be shy. I know some of you guys say that. Yeah. All right, the next one, if you get it, I will offer you a Microsoft intern. So she is a feminist. He is... anyone? Well, it's not easy to get an internship at Microsoft. Well, someone says chauvinist, and that's actually not too bad, I guess. And I know. Yeah. So the last one, if you get it, I immediately offer you a job at Microsoft full time. So she has a pregnancy. Oh my God, no. All right, so you get it. So again, it's all analyzed coming from the data. The data we collected over the internet has some inherent bias. So if we just blindly use the data to train AI, we know we have problems. So this is actually a more complete view about the number of words coming from this data set. If we plot in two dimensions, horizontal axis is all the way to the right. Those words have nothing to do with gender. All the way to the left, have very much strongly correlated with gender. If you go up, it's more about the she, and if you go down, it's more about the he. Now you really start to see problem. Why is genius, why is brilliant more associated with men versus women? So once we understand the problem, of course, we can think about how we can deal with those problems. One approach you could take is try to squash the vertical axis. And you could say that brilliant should be applied to all kinds of genders. So we actually wrote this award-winning paper. You can find that on the internet. So I only have a few minutes. Let me quickly move to the second topic, which I think is just as important. It's about the explainable AI. So why this is a problem? Because we now train all those kind of complex models with millions, even trillions of parameters. So effectively, we are building AIs as black boxes. And that's a problem, because in order to trust the AI, we need to really have a transparent AI. So we have to open the black box up to understand that each and every piece of the decisions. So I give you three reasons why we absolutely need explainable AI. The first one is very obvious. That is, AI machine learning, they are just latest tools. So we use those tools to help users to do a better job. So that is about augmenting human. Second one, I think you also probably understand pretty well. That is basically we need AI to be transparent. Why are we making those decisions? Can I trust this AI? You might think it's probably harmless to get some kind of Netflix recommendation about the movies you should watch. But the political ads on social networks can be problematic. Medical diagnosis or even military decisions based on AI can be deadly. The third one, really more for AI practitioners. That is really we want to help the humans improve AI. We need to understand, double click, really dig down to the system to understand that where are those errors happening, to which part of the data segments, with which part of the model. For example, do we see bias? Where is the bias from? So a lot of people nowadays working very, very hard, really thinking about the different kind of machine learning models. How can we make them both explainable and also very accurate? So the graph shows that the horizontal axis is really the explainability. The more you choose the right, you can actually explain. For example, logic regression, something that we all understand. And to go all the way up is actually getting bigger and bigger models, and the models are getting more and more accurate. So what's happening, what's in the field, people are really pushing very hard, is that there are two schools of thoughts. One is that you start with simple explainable models on the lower right. Then you try to explain, really improve the model, push it up. For example, the GA2M model is really this new version of generalized additive model. You know, we are developing is actually going that way. But most of the effort in the field is actually on the top left, going all the way to the right. That is, you start with some kind of very accurate model and the model agnostic. Then you try to explain, probably using some kind of local approach or other approach there. So I'm going to just finish my presentation by coming back to the black box or opening up the black box and try to convince you that it's very, very important. We have transparent AI. We are going to be the first generation of humans to ever live with AI. I see tremendous business opportunities by doing AI. I also worry about, and I believe we have also tremendous social responsibilities to develop the AI. And because I really believe we cannot accept a future where AI making decisions that we cannot explain, we cannot understand. Thank you very much.